Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome into worship today. It is good to be back with you guys this morning after a wonderful vacation, seeing the minor league baseball teams for the Chicago Cubs, and then actually seeing actual Cub bears out in the wild when we were hiking at Great Smoky Mountain National Park. In fact, in this week's newsletter, which will go out tomorrow morning, I even put up one of the pictures of one of the little cub bears that I got on my camera. It was really amazing to be in the midst of God's creation and see these beautiful creatures so close up as we did as we were driving and hiking through the national park there over last weekend. As we do come into worship today, we do have a couple of announcements this morning. First, we've got word that for those who know Barbara Gothrop, she passed away this last week and is having a service later this week. The information is found on McGuire Davies' website, so you can find it there. So we'll be praying for her family and friends this morning as they begin their grieving for them. This week, our ministries have actually quite a lot of things going on. Tomorrow night, Monday night, we have the front porch sitting, we're calling it. It's just an opportunity to gather and social and spend time together. So it's going to be at my house, on my driveway. We'll just gather there. If you want to bring a lawn chair or a beverage to share while you're there, we'll have some snacks and things. I'll bring a little fire pit thing. We'll have that in the center. And we'll just sit out, start gathering around 6:30, and we'll see if we can break curfew or something. Just stay out as long as we want to just visit all night. Later this week, Thursday night, we have our Strawberry Festival, which is a really big and fun and exciting opportunity every year for us to gather, to have a meal together here, to hear the Monmouth community band play here in our sanctuary. So that is going to be a great opportunity. It's a free will donation this year, so we don't need to sell tickets in advance. So just tell your friends and neighbors to come on in that evening for a meal and, of course, our famous ice cream and strawberry stuff, which is oh so good. Later this weekend, we've got our Synod Assembly. Judy and Gary are attending that with me, along with Trace as our youth representative. And so that's taking place Friday and Saturday up at Augustana College. So next week, Sunday, we can share some highlights from the assembly so that you can hear the things that are taking place across our whole synod next week when we gather again. Steve wanted to share something about Community Care Days today.
Also on Friday and Saturday, we're going to have Community Care Days again. We've got about 20 applications that we're going to make some ramps, we're going to do some window washing, yard work, painting. Anybody from the church is welcome to come. They don't have to be able to do everything, but they can sort of find something that they'd be happy to help out. So we're going to meet over here at the high school parking lot at 8 o'clock Friday morning and decide which direction everybody goes. Go again Saturday morning at the lot too, and work till noon at least. And then we're going to have dinner over at the Mary Cooney Hall over here on Saturday noon. It's a really rewarding experience. You find some people that need a lot of help. We had a late application for a ramp. The lady's 40 years old. She's paralyzed, I guess. And her daughter lives with her. They need a ramp to get out of the house. And she's never been in the house since she's been paralyzed.
Thank you, Steve, and I bless all the work that takes place Friday and Saturday with Community Care Days here in the community as well. Last Sunday, we didn't have the opportunity to celebrate birthdays and anniversaries, so we're going to take a moment this morning to celebrate those who has a birthday here in the month of June. Do you have any June birthdays with us? I see Rose's hand going up. Any other birthdays with us? Rose, you get a solo song just to you today. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Rose. Happy birthday to you.
92.
Congratulations on that milestone and many more blessed years for you ahead as well. Anniversaries. There's got to be some June anniversaries. Diane's got her hand up. Chip and Janice had their hands up. Pam's got her hand up. Rob's got his hand up. Warren's got his hand up. Judy and Gary have their hands up. Kathy and Doug and Beck have their hands up. Lots of June anniversaries. It's almost as if June is a popular month to get married in. All right, let's start getting some anniversary numbers, and let's go back over on this side. How many years?
41.
Congratulations to 41. 51 years. Congratulations to 51. 48. What a blessed mark there.
34.
In the back, Doug and Kathy?
49.
Congratulations. Warren, you had your hand. 51 also. Let's see, Rob, you had your hand up?
34.
34 also then. All right. These are some amazing amounts of years of commitment and love to one another. Is a testimony to how God continues to work in your lives. It keeps you through all the thick and thin, the sick and healthy, and all the other things that we promise at marriage. So, congratulations to you all on all those wonderful milestones of anniversaries this month. This month, our vision purpose has been for Wendy Anderson and her St. Jude run to Peoria. I have in the newsletter an article by her. She wasn't sure, because of her schedule, if she'd get here on Sunday morning here to talk about it herself, but she did send me an article, so that's in the newsletter. It does have multiple ways that we can contribute to her run, including through the church. So if you put that in through our vision and purpose giving, then our endowment fund will be able to match those up to $150 plus the $100 that the endowment already gives to it this month. So please do consider providing what you're going to support through Wendy through the church, and then that way it'll get matched. But there are other ways to support her, and those are in the newsletter as well as her article about what the run is about. St. Jude's is a great organization as a hospital, providing all that health care to children in ways that those children, when they come to receive their health care there, they don't have to pay for that. So all of this goes to help that ministry that they do there. Those are all the things that I want to share here as we enter into worship this morning. Let's take a moment to collect ourselves, breathe in the Holy Spirit, and enter into worship as we listen now to our prelude music. Oh yes, we've got the mission statement to come into it. Let's share our mission statement. Gathered by God, we live our faith with compassion, grace, gratitude, and joy. invite you to stand now as we start fresh this morning with our moment of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily love, magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves to the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's take a moment now to share a sign of God's peace. Our opening hymn this morning is Built on a Rock.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Our call to worship today is based on Psalm 130. Draw us into worship, Lord. Lift us from the depths where we hide all our despair.
Hear
me cry out for your help. Assuredly, my prayer is heard. Cleanse us for worship, Lord. Erase every mark of sin that we may stand in your presence.
Hear
me cry out for your help. Assure me of your forgiveness. Ready us for worship, Lord. Fill our souls with eagerness to meet you this new day.
Hear
me cry out for your help. Assure me my trust in your word does not fail. Center us in worship, Lord. Bless us with good news of unending love.
Hear
me cry out for your help. Assure me of your redemption, the first and last word for all God's beloved. Let us pray. All-powerful God, in Jesus Christ, you turn death into life and defeat into victory. Increase our faith and trust in him, that we may triumph over all evil in the strength of the same Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us sing our hymn of praise, O God, beyond all praise.
Peace. In his flesh, he has made both into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us, abolishing the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And a reading from the Gospel of St. Mark, the third chapter. Then he went home, and the crowd came together again, so that they could not even eat. When his family heard this, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, "He has gone out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, "He has Beelzebub, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons." And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. But his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly, I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they had said, "He has an unclean spirit." Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers are outside asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sat around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." The word of the Lord.
I'm going to start by apologizing for last week's Sunday. I understand that we had some technical difficulties last week. It's because before I left, I forgot to plug in the little cord that allowed the computer's sound system to come through our regular sound system. And that was on me. So I'm sorry for that. I hope that when I sent out the video on Monday, that everybody was able to get that and see that. We're starting a series on the book of Ephesians. This is a letter by Paul. And in that first message, I kind of cover some background on who Paul is, about the community of Ephesus that he's writing to, and how that opening chapter relates not only to what Paul was writing to in that day, but to us today. We continue in that series today with this long stretch of Paul writing as Paul does, in that style which we can only attribute to Paul, a style which feels like, Judy said this ahead of time, even a long run-on sentence. Part of that reason for Paul being kind of difficult to read, and this isn't just his letter to the Ephesians, it's all the letters that are Paul's, is because we're translating from ancient Greek to English. And Ancient Greek, first of all, did not have punctuation marks like we do. So translators, a lot of times, have to guess where the period goes, where the comma goes, what's a quotation, what's not a quotation. And that's true not only for Paul, but for all the ancient texts. Even ancient Hebrew also did not use punctuation like we do. So whenever you're reading your English translations and you're seeing punctuation in there, that's because some translator decided, yep, this is where I'm going to put the period. And this is how I think this collection of words makes a sentence. So that's one of the struggles in translating Paul and all the other ancients. But Paul in particular, because his Greek writing style uses an argumentative format, a dialogue kind of writing style that we're just not as familiar with in our way that we communicate and speak today. So we have to kind of parse out Paul a little bit. We have to stop and reread and understand what is it you're saying here, Paul. Break down the argument and get at the heart of what he's getting at. Paul is writing in this letter to a community called Ephesus. Just a couple quick reminders. Ephesus is located on the coastline of what today we would call modern Turkey, or Turkey, as they're asking their nation to be known as. It's now a city that's in ruins, doesn't exist anymore. But in ancient times, this city, Ephesus, was considered a capital city for that region. It had an estimated population of over 250,000 people. So it is also a very diverse community because it represented people who today we would say are Turkish, Greek, Israeli or Jewish, Palestinian, people from Italy, so those who today we call Italians or Romans in that era. They would have had folks from Africa there, from all the different nations along the Mediterranean in particular, because they're all part of the Roman Empire. This was a trading hub. It was a city of great importance for the Roman Empire, for politics. It was also a place of great entertainment. They had a wonderful amphitheater there for all sorts of dramas that they would have put on and other forms of Roman entertainment. They also had temples there to most of the major Roman Greco gods and goddesses. You know, they had a pantheon of gods and goddesses. All those stories today that we call outright myths, they used those gods and goddesses to explain the natural phenomena around us. They used them to curry favor in their business transactions, in their married lives, in their farming and agricultural life cycles, everything from planting to harvesting. There is a Roman or Greco god for all of it. And this was this very diverse city. And when Paul first traveled to Ephesus, he came there to a Jewish community that was there also. Because the people of Israel also were scattered around throughout the whole Roman Empire as well. There were people who left Israel because they were going to other places for business, for trade, to get out and see the world and travel, all those things. Some of those folks probably got to Ephesus and went, wow, this is a great place. I'm not going home now. I'm going to stay here. And they set up their own community. And they had their own synagogue. And it probably wasn't that large a portion of that 250,000 plus population, but it was a significant sized group that they would always get together and tell their stories of their faith and recall Yahweh and temple life and tell the stories. And they would have had the scrolls that would have been brought with them. And they would have had a rabbi who would have come as well and set up a shop there to teach, to lead the worship, to read the Holy Scriptures as well. So that's what Paul finds when he comes here. He's traveling now because he has encountered the risen Christ. He has had a complete overhaul of his system of understanding how God functions in the world. He's realized that everything that he has been taught was taught from the wrong perspective. And now that he knows Jesus, he has learned the right perspective to understand all of which he's been taught. And so as he goes from community to community to community, he is there to bring what he has learned is that right perspective of everything that he's been taught. Everything he has been taught has been based on this notion that as a covenant person, that is, as somebody who has been circumcised, that somebody who believes in Yahweh according to the right teaching of the law, of the law of Moses, no less, that as a covenant person who performs the proper ritual sacrifices at the temple at the proper moments throughout the year, that he and those who also are part of the covenant are the only ones that God loves. That they're the only ones that God has revealed to. That they're the only ones God is going to save as the rest of the world falls apart. That's how he was raised. That's what he was taught to believe. And the Jewish people had a word for everybody on the outside. And that word was Gentile. So it's a very clean system of understanding the world. From the Jewish perspective, you either were in, because you were circumcised and you're in the covenant, or you're out, and you're a Gentile. And we can't have anything to do with anything Gentile, because having anything to do with something that's Gentile or somebody that's Gentile would make us unclean, would take us out of the covenant, and we'd have to go through all sorts of ritual practices in order to get right again with God. That's how Paul was raised. In his encounter with Jesus, the risen Jesus, who met him on the road to Damascus, he heard that he was being sent into Damascus not to persecute Christians, but to go to the house of one of them named Ananias, where he would learn from Ananias the right perspective on understanding how God works in the world now, and would be baptized, and would receive the instruction he needed to go out on all these journeys and go to tell people that the system of understanding the world as you're either in or you're out is now officially ended. This is not how God is going to engage the world. God is not going to engage the world in this notion of who's in and who's out. An imaginary barrier that the religious orders have set up is gone. It's a great cartoon that gets circulated every now and then in social media, but it goes back even further than that. I don't remember where exactly it originated. But it's got a picture of a bunch of people going around with pencils and drawing pencil lines on the ground. There's Jesus, his pencil's upside down. He's got the eraser, and he's erasing every line that every person is drawing. So this is the new teaching that Paul has, and this is what he's taking with him. When he was in Ephesus, this is how he taught. Now he has left Ephesus, and he's writing back to Ephesus because there's some conflict going on there again, and he's reminding them of what it means to live in God's kingdom. And it means we don't separate based on who's in and who's out. For we are all a part of the same love of God in Christ Jesus. Those who have always been near, Paul says, using that as a metaphor to describe those who are Jewish, those who are the covenant people, those who are circumcised, and those who are far off. That metaphor that Paul uses to describe those who are Gentile, those who didn't grow up in the covenant relationship with God, those who didn't grow up Jewish, those who didn't know who Yahweh is. And yet, through Christ, all have the opportunity to become one community. So Paul is writing this letter to a community that is extremely diverse, religiously, politically, culturally, and he's saying we are all one. He's basing this passage on a firm belief that God works in grace, a free gift to us. Just a few verses before this passage begins in Ephesians 2, verse 8, Paul writes, "For you have been saved by grace, not by works, so that no one may boast." And you have been saved by grace through faith, not by your works, so that no one may boast. That is the foundation of this wonderful image that Paul is casting here, telling us that we are all one community. We're not two communities. We're not three and four communities. We're one community in God through Christ. Sometimes it feels like these words that Paul wrote to the Ephesians almost 2,000 years ago are just as applicable to us today. For though we don't see ourselves in who's in and who's out in terms of the covenant that the ancient Jewish peoples would have used, we still do have this sort of inside club and outside club mentality when it comes to our Christian faith. It's part of the popular cultural Christianity that floats around. Those who are near, in Paul's metaphor, are those who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Those who are near to Christ are those who attend worship properly, tithe correctly, lead all sorts of great prayers, and are reading their Bibles constantly, and are eschewing things of the world. Whereas those who are far off, those who don't come to worship, those who don't believe in Jesus, those who follow the ways of the world, do all those nasty, terrible things that we like to moralize and ethicize and make as the new barriers to who's in and who's out. Sometimes we do that culturally through religious ways. Sometimes we apply that in terms of cultures, of what's the right way of being cultured and what's the wrong way of being cultured. Sometimes we apply that to politics. Who's got the right version of politics? Who's got the wrong version of politics? Sometimes we apply that in terms of citizenship, as we deal in our modern day and age with issues of immigration, issues of those seeking asylum or those seeking refuge. Many ways that we apply these in and out standards, very similarly to how it was applied in the ancients. Paul's letter reminds us that there is not two communities, not three communities, not four communities. There are no lines of division. For in Christ, we have been unified in one community. In Christ's death, the hostility between us and those that we've deemed others, those that we think are the far-off ones, that hostility is ended. It's over. I finally found The Chosen Season 4 is being streamed, and there's this beautiful scene in the second episode of the next season, as they've released the first two episodes free now. I got to watch them both yesterday. There's this beautiful scene, and the character Simon Peter reconciles with Matthew. There's been this hostility between them from the beginning episodes, when Matthew was a tax collector, and in this narrative is how it was set up in the storyline. Matthew's excessive tax collecting almost got Peter and his brother Andrew arrested, and they're both seized. And Simon Peter's been holding hostility against him for this entire strain of episodes, the first three seasons. Even as they follow Jesus, you can see that they are just standoffish. Poor Matthew, trying to figure out what he can do to make it right, comes and visits and talks to Jesus, and Jesus says, well, have you tried to apologize? And he goes and he apologizes, and Simon Peter is like, and he comes back to Jesus and says, well, now what do I do? He apologized, but I still hate him for all he did. Did you try forgiving him? At the end of the episode, all that is working out. And Simon walks over to Matthew and gives him this massive hug. And you can see, I don't know how the actor does this, because you can see this weight of the burden just lift off of him. As he says, it's over. I'm forgiving you. I'm holding nothing against you ever again. It's a beautiful, beautiful act and scene. That represents this hostility that Paul is talking about, that's between those who call themselves the insiders and those that the insiders say are the outsiders. That hostility is ended. It's gone. Imagine, if you will, if you truly lived with this perspective that Paul is offering us. Imagine if we truly broke down those walls of separation. If we truly said to another, you are one in Christ as I am one in Christ, let there be love and peace between us. Imagine how that would play out in our modern day political conversations. Imagine how that would play out in our modern day conversations and dealings with those who are trying to come to America for a better life. But for whom culturally we're told, oh, no, no, not those people. Imagine how it would be different. Imagine how it would be different to go up to somebody who identifies on the LGBTQ scale of identities and sexual understandings in their own lives. And instead of there being hostility between us because we don't understand that, we reconcile by saying, Christ has made you one God, just as Christ has made me one in God. Let's embrace and be one in one community. Paul had to come to this understanding on a roadside, blinding vision as he was heading to Damascus to persecute Christians. We don't need that same roadside experience. Just simply need to take Paul at his word. That in Christ, we are one with God. And when we realize, the same as Paul, that I didn't do anything to make me one in God with Christ, but it's Christ whose death on the cross and resurrection is what made me one in God through Christ, then if that happened for me, that happened for you, that happened for somebody I think is on the outside, just as much. What a beautiful world this would be if we could live that vision completely. Paul will, as the letter of Ephesians continue to talk about this construct of grace and how it shapes us in our community. And Paul will talk about how grace now forms us into new beings and how that shapes our lives going forward. But for here, for now, we rest in this grace. Because we don't get to boast over anything except that Christ is the one whose death and resurrection made each of us a member of an eternal community. applies not just to the insiders, but to the outsiders as well. And we can sigh a relief that we don't have to judge who's in and who's out anymore. And just behold the wholeness of the community that God has formed in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's just stand as we sing our hymn of the day, for by grace you have been saved.
Teach us to cultivate the earth with respect and reverence. Merciful God,
we hear our prayer.
Our nations and communities are divided. O God, teach us again to listen with curiosity and mercy, even in disagreement. Grant us the humility to acknowledge our hardness of heart and make us bold in modeling cooperation for the sake of the common good. Merciful God, hear the prayers of all who cry out to you from the depths of fear, despair, or hopelessness, especially Linda, Isla, Kathy, Dean, Emily, Gary, Cecil, Janet, Brian, Hannah, Carol, Suzanne, and the family and friends of Barb Gothra. With haste, rescue victims of trafficking, exploitation, and abuse, and bless organizations and individuals who work on their behalf. Merciful God,
grant
Grant wisdom and clarity to all who are in seasons of discernment and transition. High school graduates preparing for first jobs or new educational journeys, those who are shifting careers, and those who are navigating changes in their relationships. Accompany them with your peace. Merciful God, praise to you for our ancestors in faith, who believed, spoke, and lived in you. Give us confidence that as Jesus was raised, so we too will be raised with all the saints into your everlasting presence. Merciful God, receive our prayers, O God, and come quickly to our aid through the power of the Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now for offerings gathered through many and various ways, give us the spirit of joy and thankfulness, we pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Sing now our opening hymn for communion, Now the Silence. Gave thanks and gave it for all the drinks, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. This meal unites us with saints across the globe and spanning the ages, all of whom cry out in one voice the same prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us sing now. Now we join in celebration, just the first verse.
Thank you.
invites you forward, will receive communion, the gifts that Jesus offers. Let us pray. Nourishing God, at this table, you were the host who became the meal, and you gathered us to receive that we may be the gift. Send us to a hungry world yearning for what you offer, that they may taste and see the Lord is good. Amen. We should stand as we sing our closing hymn, Victory in Jesus. Benediction refrain is, goodness is stronger than evil.